We could say that perception is the problem. Perception is the problem. Let us say this. And let us start out. Welcome to the video. We're starting out with the real key. Perception is the problem. Just hear this and hear it and hear it and hear it and wow it. Perception is the problem. And you feel like, uh-oh, here we go. Right? Yeah. Wow. Where are we going with this? So first we kind of get over the opening jitters here. All right, we've opened with a bang. Wow. A crescendo. Perception is the problem. What? Perception is something we're imagining, spirits imagining, to disempower reality, pure awareness, to disempower it, to deny it, to disempower it. This is what we made perception for. And perception is actually a form. Get this. Perception is actually a form. Consciousness is perception, actually. Consciousness is a form. Believe it or not, it's a form. Consciousness is not our identity. Perception is not our identity. That's a false identity designed to disempower our true identity, which is pure awareness. Pure awareness. Pure awareness. Now, is pure perception pure awareness? No. And we will explain this. Again, just wow this. Say, oh my gosh, where are we going? Wow. And I'll just let it sink in here. This is what we're going to take a little look at this together. We'll look at this. It's not a problem. I've already looked at it. And it's not a problem at all. In fact, the day's gone very well. Started off very bad, poorly. I was very upset. I feel like I failed. You know, I haven't done what I need to do. And it's not good. And got some good comment, space of allowance, nice, beautiful comment, thank you, in the morning, and it gave me a boost, and it pulled me out of this kind of despondency, and I said, hey, you know, wait a minute, let's get going here, and the day built, and built, and built, and built, and miracles started happening. I prayed to Longchenpa and his vast array of, that he has, and miracles start popping up like this. I mean, I'm almost afraid to pray to Longchenpa. Miracles happen so fast, I've never experienced anything quite like it. I just, oh my gosh, what's going to happen next? Last time I prayed to him, I had the bliss body, Sambhogakaya vision of him. And since then, I've been afraid to pray to him, ask him for, I said, well, is this going to be, it's going to top that? I mean, wow, I don't know. So I'm trying. Hey, it's this extraordinary array, these top Tibetan master gurus, they just, I mean, how much, what is their court like, you know? Wow. there's never been anyone who got after it any more better than they did. That tradition, I mean, I just, it's almost incomprehensible, the dedication they had. And their determination to keep this transmission going. I mean, it's just beggars description, actually. But in gratitude to it, what do we do? I'm so grateful for it. Well, to ask them to help us. They did all of this work so they could be helpful to us. So if we don't allow them to help us, we're not being grateful. It's going to waste. It's going to waste. They're already enlightened, but they take a bodhisattva vow. I mean, they're here to help us be enlightened. So we say, Longchenpa, absolutely, anything and everything you would like to do, we accept it right now, in the now. All empowerment is invested in the now. So, whatever if you whatever you do is okay. We've given a blank check to you, so we'll just accept whatever you want to do. Say okay, you know, this much, how we can express gratitude towards you and all of like you who have slaved away most incredibly simply for our welfare. It's really very humbling. So I said, yeah, okay. Anything you want to help with, anything, any way we can help you, blank check, whatever you like. So we can express gratitude, because we wouldn't be where we are today, right now, without the help of these great traditions. We would not. There's no way we would be here, and being you know, effectively looking at this. No way. It's permeated our consciousness to such an extent that we're able to have the confidence. We have the confidence to look at this. Now, I said perception is the problem. Perception is a form. It's a form. It's form. Perception is form. Get that. Even pure perception is form. How about that? It is too. But pure perception is able to see intrinsic spaciousness. It's still seeing it. It's the final form. Pure perception is the final form of it that we need. And then from there, we don't even need any form at all anymore. But we'll just know. We'll just know. We'll just know reality. We'll be reality. We are reality. But first, we need to perceive the intrinsic spaciousness. So we shift our... Now, get this. What we do, all we do... is we simply go from one form of perception to another. Exchange one form of perception for another. We exchange sensory perception, we call it, for clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. That's a form of perception. Now, perception can take on, I imagine, many different forms, actually. Consciousness takes on many different forms. Consciousness is just a form of perception. All these different consciousnesses, yeah. So... The one form that frees us from all other forms of perception is what they call pure perception, or Jesus, in the Course of Miracles, they use a term healed perception sometimes, or vision of oneness, vision of Christ. That's perception still. It's still a form. So all we have to do is, here's an analogy. It's like we look at our driveway, and there's like a car in it, a car we drive. And that's sensory perception. It's a form, like a car. It's a form that we're driving. Takes us various places, like a car. But we look in our driveway, or if we were to look in our driveway more carefully, we'd see there's another car there. We were driving along a couple days ago. It was Sunday, I believe. Yeah. And I noticed this car in my left side mirror. I was driving. And I said, whoa, what is that? Wow, it looks like a Ferrari. And then it came level with us. And then, it went ahead of us a little bit. And I was watching, looking. I said, hey, look at that Ferrari. It's a new one. It's a new style Ferrari. Wow, was that a nice looking car. Of course, it's red with the yellow Ferrari, you know, emblem. It was just sparkling brand new. It must have been 2017 model or I don't know. They remodeled the Ferrari, and yet it looks fabulous. So we were just like, wow. we want to just keep up with this Ferrari, because it looks so fast, but without trying to look fast. I mean, it's just really a great redesign. Like, wow. So imagine that if we look at our driveway, we see our car, the prosaic car that we drive, and then next to that in the driveway, there's a second car, and it's this brand new Ferrari. Wow. Now, Most of us ignore this. In fact, we think there's something wrong with us. Just say, I just feel my life is kind of something weird about my life because I got this car. I know it's my car. This is me. This is what I, you know. But I get this feeling like there's another car in my driveway, and I don't know where it came from, whose it is. I wish I would get it out of here. It just bugs me. I can't. It's like a mystery. I don't know what to say about it. It's like this. So here's the answer to the mystery. Is the Holy Spirit put that Ferrari in your driveway? In fact, everyone has a Ferrari, a brand new Ferrari in their driveway. This is a fact. And that brand new Ferrari in everyone's driveway is pure perception. Pure perception. And you can't get rid of it because the Holy Spirit owns the car and put it there and won't let you take it away. You have to drive it. You can't have it hauled away. You can't have a tow truck come and tow it. It's immovable as far as someone trying to tow it away. But when you get in to drive it, you're driving that Ferrari. And I just got this feeling seeing that new Ferrari. So, I'd like to drive a Ferrari like that. That was a nice car. Wow. I mean, if it had a set of wings, it could fly. Yeah. Really, that comes from Little Deuce Coupe, of course, the Beach Boys. So this is something very profound and important, but very simple. Just look at it like this analogy. We have two cars in our driveway. We have two forms of perception. We have sensory perception we're using now, but we also have this other form of perception called pure perception, which is clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, where it's simply obvious to us. Intrinsic spaciousness is obvious to us. We see it. We perceive it, actually. Not with sensory perception, but with this Ferrari-like perception. Okay. Clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So I'm driving along today, and suddenly it pops into my mind, this whole issue about impermanence. You know, Buddhism is wrapped up in this issue of impermanence. And I said, wait a minute. I said, is self-abidance impermanent? Is abidance and intrinsic spaciousness, is that impermanent? I said, wait, show me one thing in the world that is not abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness right now. Show me what is impermanent in that regard. I'm driving, I look at that telephone pole. Well, it's abiding in its telephone pole spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness of a... The dirt that it's in is abiding in intrinsic spaciousness, its own intrinsic spaciousness. And the air is abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness. And the telephone wire is, and the road is, and the grasses, and the weeds, and the trees. And I said, where is all this impermanence that they talk about? I mean, isn't everything permanently abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness? Does something leave that? Is there some sort of impermanence there? Say, I was abiding in it. I used to abide in it, my intrinsic spaciousness, but I'm not anymore, you know. So my abidance in intrinsic spaciousness is impermanent? Where's the impermanence? Is it not sensory perception that shows us impermanence? Gives us a sense of impermanence, a feeling of impermanence? How about that Ferrari? How would it feel like to drive that Ferrari of pure perception, which sees everything is always intrinsic, abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness, never leaves it? Where's the impermanence then? Different feel to it, huh? Believe me, it's a different feel. It's a difference. Like when I had that experience, I'll get to that. Let's not get ahead of ourselves here. Just wow. It was time to just wow it. Say, wow. We just looked at this whole impermanence thing and just looked at it in a different way, didn't we? Man, Maybe I'm drinking too much lemonade. It's sour, too sour. Get my stomach. It's sour. It's strong. Ah. I started a different workout thing today, kind of. I've sort of like a shifted gears into a more rigorous type of thing. Instead of just doing the same old stuff, I'm now kind of doing stuff that's a different level of difficulty. Interesting. It just happened. I said, let me try this. Wow. Kind of sort of leaping, doing more leaping. That's a different thing than jogging, isn't it? There's different levels. You could jog. But you see people that just all they do is jog. But how fit are they really? Because I've done that before where you can just kind of shuffle along. And I saw that this half marathon, the people that I saw running this thing, I said, they didn't look fit at all. They're just obese. I was very shocked by it. I said, what's going on here? But you can get into this shuffle mode of jogging and just keep doing it. Keep going. You can run a half marathon or even a marathon. But is that real fitness? I don't think so. So I'm now doing like more twisting exercises with weights, twisting kind of things with awkward weights, you know, awkwardness, twisting and bending and twisting with that kind of stuff. Because this is real life stuff. Let me get this and let me, you know, carry this from here to here. I got to lift this up. You know, it's all about being off balance in awkward positions and having to use your strength in awkward positions too. And being able to spring or leap also is important too. Whoa. It's just there's something about that quality of jump, being able to jump or leap even off of one leg, you know, springiness, some sort of springiness. So this is sort of a different level of fitness, springiness. And springiness is starting here as summerness starts, because it started here today. The heat hit 98 degrees. I don't even know what it is in other places, but it's got to be scorching. It's supposed to get really hot. Phoenix and Palm Springs, Friday's 117, supposed to be getting like in Palm Springs or that area. Just 117, wow. That's hot. I like that. I said, wow, let me go to Palm Springs. I want to be there. Are you kidding? That'd be great. In Phoenix area, everybody's got a swimming pool. Everybody swims. It's amazing how much time they spend in swimming pools there. They don't have heated swimming pools. They have cooled swimming pools. They have to cool it down, right? Otherwise, the water would get way too hot. I don't know how you cool swimming pools down, but there must be a way. But boy, are they swimmers down there. It's a culture, really. So at some point in your exercise, you realize you got to leave the old exercises behind because you can already do them and you're just repeating the same motions and it's starting to become robotic and you need to do something that is more challenging, you know, how to keep your balance and you got a heavy weight here trying to pull you off balance and you move here, you know, and you got to use your whole body. You start getting into whole body strength rather than just like I'm doing the barbells here. And, you know, like that. I mean, what is that? Is that challenging your full body strength? What's that great surfer? I forget his name. But the big wave surfer. He said, exercise, you have to keep challenging yourself to different types of exercises and keep challenging your balance, sort of thing, and strength in that way, full body strength sort of exercises. That's what's really, really produces fitness. And boy, you better need fitness when you're riding those really big waves. You can't make a mistake. You've got to be able, you know, just to handle even a pounding by the wave. It's just amazing. They're very fit. So that's the next level of fitness. The next level of spiritual fitness is what we're shifting into also here. We're shifting into the next level of spiritual fitness here. That's what we're doing. We're looking directly now at perception as a form. And the answer, our salvation comes from just choosing another form. It's like driving another car, that's all. What about the old car? Just leave it in the driveway. Just drive the new one. Same road, drive on the road. Different feel. Gone is this feeling of forsakenness and impermanence, destituteness and all this, and it's gone. This is what we're told. It's a different feel. I've noticed that like my overall body's strength is better. This is what you find out. It's not like you get a bunch of big muscles. No, there's no, like, you know, don't have any muscles at all still. But the overall body strength is better. I've noticed that. I said, wow, I didn't struggle lifting this. I have some sort of core. I can feel my core is strong. And this makes a difference. Makes a difference, but it's not really noticeable. I mean, you look at me, I don't look strong, but I'm stronger than I used to be. I may be in the best shape of my life, actually. It has to do with the core strength, you know, that this is, but overall, just the overall strength, you're able to function, and it seems easier. It seems easier. You don't strain your back, for instance. You don't feel, oh, I don't know how I can do this, or you just have some ability to do it. You say, okay, this is what it feels like. But it's not like radically different. It's just smoother. It's smoother. Everything is smoother. All your movements, you know, doing things. So that's easy. That was easy. That was easy. That was easy. That was easy. Everything you do feels easy. This is sort of the way it goes now. That's not heavy. That's not heavy. I can do this. Easy, 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 easy. So the whole day, everything you do, easy. So this builds up this feeling like, I got this feeling of like, life is sort of easier now. It's easier. It's not like what we felt like when we were younger and like tip-top shape. We thought, oh, this is easy. This is easy. And then when you're out of shape, everything's difficult. Oh, this is difficult. Ah, I got to get up. That's so difficult to get up. I got to walk over here. Got to do the steps. It's difficult. Got to pick this up. Oh, I'm going to hurt myself. I might fall down. I'll lose my balance. That's difficult. I'm having trouble. Struggling here. Struggling there. Struggle. Struggle, 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 struggle. Difficult, difficult, difficult. Yeah, but here it's like, oh. In fact, when you walk, you kind of like want to just kind of do a little hop, skip, jump, and just like practice like being off balance just because it's fun to recover so easily. And it's like, wow, I just feel like dancing, you know. It's very nice, very cool. Sort of a nimbleness and a smoothness and an ease. That's, but it's just subtle. It's just the edge of difficulty, and a lot of stuff is sort of like a butter knife. It's not so sharp. It doesn't really cut you anymore. So this is the result that I'm experiencing, and I'm shifting into some more difficult full body strength type of exercises here. And that will produce its aches and pains and difficulties, but that too will bring about something. I don't know what really, but we'll find out. And you really can't get to this until you build up, already do the other steps beforehand. It's too intimidating. You just, oh, I could do that once, but I don't feel like doing that too much. It's, that's not, it's just, you just don't want to do it. But when you're in pretty good shape, then you say, oh, I feel ready for this challenge. This morning I got up, I said, I feel ready for a challenge today. I really want to be challenged. Well, it came about. It came about. Spiritually too, spiritually challenged today. At no point does anything ever leave its intrinsic spaciousness. So everything is just like a display. And even though the display is constantly changing, the unchanging fact is that it's never, at any point, does display ever leave intrinsic space, its own intrinsic spaciousness. At no point ever. Nothing ever leaves God, in other words. Now, you get in that Ferrari, and it's got a steering wheel, accelerator, brake, and you can drive it like a drive a car. Yeah. I felt like I could drive that Ferrari that I saw. I said, "Well, thinking about it right now, just considering, can I drive? Should I? Can I? Could I drive such a car?" I said, "Well, who's driving? A guy. Usually in a red Ferrari, it's a guy." In a white VW convertible, it's a gal or something, They used to drive rabbits, white convertible rabbits. Ever saw a white convertible rabbit? It was always a cheerleader driving that car, right? Always, always. You never saw a guy driving a white VW rabbit convertible. Never, never, never. It was the weirdest thing. And pretty much the red Ferraris, it's pretty much the guys driving those. So, but he's just driving it, just a t-shirt, and I think it was a convertible. Yeah, it's convertible, and I don't know. He's just ordinary guy. It was nothing. He was just enjoying the ride. I said, "Huh." So in my mind, I'm thinking, could I drive that Ferrari? Ask yourself in your own mind, could you drive that Ferrari? Just as your everyday car, just you get out in the driveway and you say, I think I'm gonna drive the Ferrari today. Where are you going? Oh, wherever I go, you're just driving it. Would you feel self-conscious? Now, in the past, I would have said, yeah. If I check in with myself, I start imagining yourself, this is what you're doing. Going to the market, pull up the market, you get out, you go inside the store, you come out, your Ferrari, and you drive to the next place. And of course, everybody's looking at you for sure. Everybody's going to say, whoa, look at that Ferrari. Wow. Wow. It's like what we were looking at. I mean, you couldn't help but look at it. It's really sweet. sweet ride. So consider, imagine yourself. Remember, all these videos are practice videos. As Longchenpa said, if you just, Ramana Maharshi, if you read all the scriptures, well, Longchenpa said something similar too. If you read all the holy books, all the scriptures, all this, but you don't practice, he said, it's no use to you. It's no good for you. It doesn't do you any good, actually. It's only supposed to inspire you to practice. So we're always trying to use these videos to practice. Imagine yourself in this scenario. You got this red Ferrari in your driveway, brand new. I mean, it is just sparkling red. It's flawless. I mean, it is just a sweet, sweet ride, hands down. And you know it. Everybody knows it. Can you get up? Can you drive down your street in that? How about your friends? Go to your friends' houses. Go to a restaurant in that. Come on, you get out. Go to the restaurant. Come out. Go to your friends where they're working, or you know, whatever people where you work. The people you drive. Can you drive to work in that? Go to work and get out of the Ferrari and go to work. And you know, people are gonna say, "Oh, you know, what are they gonna say? What are they gonna think?" That kind of stuff. So imagine yourself in that scenario. So I'm just. Imagine yourself in that scenario. Give yourself a little time here just to imagine yourself. How do you feel? How do you feel? Now, this one was different. This wasn't like, look at me, I want to be a Formula One driver or something. Or, no, it was just more just like, this is like very sporty, very sweet, very beautiful, very powerful, fast, but not like I want to head down to Laguna Seca. I want to hit the, you know, Sears Point. I want to get the, you know, I'm like Mr. or Mrs. Race Car Driver. No, it wasn't like that. It wasn't like that. It had overtones of like a Camaro or a Mustang or something, or a muscle car, but it was sleeker and elegant. And it was more just, you know, it's like a nice, nice fit, really nice fit. And it probably could go 140 in the top ain't floored or the top end floored both ways. Sure it could, but it looks just as good just cruising at 30. You know, it's not the typical thing of the fries. He's going like 30. It feels like, you know, I can hardly hold it back. I look beautiful just going just average speed. So it was like sort of understated Ferrari. So I said, wow, I like that Ferrari better. The other one, I just don't like the other ones that just look, they're too ostentatious. They're too, but this one, no. I said, wow, I wouldn't mind driving around in that. So just keep this practice in mind. Put yourself in a situation where obviously you've got a sweet ride, okay? And most people don't have that sweet ride right at this point. But keep in mind, it's in their driveway. Everyone's got one. It's just very few drive it. Pure perception. Very few here have pure perception. But it's a gift from the Holy Spirit. Pure perception is still a form, but it's a gift from the Holy Spirit to everyone. Everyone in the world, and not even in this world, everywhere, they have this Ferrari in their driveway, pure perception. But what we do is we overlook it. And we think there's something wrong with us. Like, why is that car there? That's weird. That's bizarre. It's not mine. Who's it belong to? We don't know. So, you know, we're ignorant of this fact. It's ours. It belongs to us. It's a gift of God. It's a gift that God gave to every one of us. So in gratitude for what God has done, the way we express this gratitude is by driving the car. It's like an obligation to do it, actually. We got no choice. The only way we can be saved is first see clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, and from then there we can set perception down altogether. This is what A Course in Miracles points out very clearly. There's this intermediate step. But first, you have this pure perception. First, you see the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Then, from there, ultimately, you don't even need perception anymore. Your continuity fear vanishes entirely. This is how it goes for us. So it's really obligation to do it. But very few do it. And so we have all these defenses against that car. It's like, you know, we just don't even pay attention anymore. It's amazing what our attention can do. Like, I've lived in the same place virtually my entire life. I was driving down a street a while ago, and I saw this barbershop, and I just said, did a double take. I said, what is that? I said, whoa, I've never seen that before. When was that built? I said, look, it's like it's been here a long time. The sign says, you know, like, I said, why? That's not possible. So I started asking people. I said, have you ever seen this barbershop before? When would that open up here? And they said, no, it's been here a long, long time. I said, no, what are you talking about? And they said, yeah, it's always been there. And I said, whoa, I've never seen it. But I've been down that road thousands of times. And it's really shocking to you to me is that I never saw it. It's sort of a nondescript area, you know. It had no value or importance or something. So I never paid attention. So you may have these same experiences. You're driving through where you live, and you'll see something and say, "Wait a minute, has that always been there? I don't think I've ever seen that before. How could I not have seen that? Isn't that amazing?" This happens occasionally, right? Well, it's like that with that Ferrari in our driveway, the Ferrari of pure perception. It's always been there. But we're systematically taught to not pay any attention to it. This is what happens here in this world. Now, I was aware of it when I was younger. But people say, that's not your car. What are you doing driving that car? You can't drive that car. This is your car over here. That's somebody else's car. We don't know whose car that belongs to. It's some really rich, maybe it's Jesus' car or something, but, you know, if you want to call it that, or, you know, some Mahatma's car, or we don't even know whose car it is, really, or maybe it's just an imaginary car, but don't pay any attention to it. Just imagine it's an imaginary car, and it doesn't really exist. So systematically, this world causes us to have this defense complex that it basically denies the car's even there. So that's just a make-believe car. If you see that car, you're hallucinating. Really. This is how we feel. So we get out and we go to our car and we drive and we come back and we say, doggone it, I'm still hallucinating. That red Ferrari is still there. I've still seen it. And I gotta go to psychotherapy and tell a therapist, your therapist, you know, he said, well, what's wrong? Please tell me. Well, you know, I'm still hallucinating. I'm hallucinating a red Ferrari in my driveway. Very interesting. Tell me some more about that, you know. Do you want to drive it? No, I don't want to drive it. You know, I want to get rid of it. You know, it's not mine. It bugs me, you know, because it's a hallucination. It's a hallucination, yeah. And so, you know, all these people are going to therapy to get rid of this hallucination. They think something's wrong with them. They're hallucinating. Isn't that something? They think there's something profoundly wrong with them because they shouldn't be seeing that car, Ferrari, yet they're still seeing it. And it's like, wow. What's the matter with me? So we actually see it as some sort of pathology. Very much so. I was so attacked, you know, when I was young for insisting, oh, we all have a red Ferrari, you know, we all have this pure perception. He said, no, you're crazy. You know, that's a sign of insanity. You got to get that educated out of you. We'll help. Don't worry. We'll help you with that. Well, long story short, brought about insane misery for me. And the Ferrari's still there. It's still there. And still in your driveway, too. Still in everyone's driveway. And if you don't have a driveway, it's parked outside your curb. Wherever you may be, it's parked there. It's yours. It's yours to drive. The key's in it, actually. Nobody else can drive it but you, though. It's one of those personal identity keys that only, you know, are actually, you don't even use the key. It's like a, it's just a, it gets your vibe and you just, it unlocks for you, and only you can drive it. Anyone else tries to drive it, they can't. But so it's your Ferrari, your pure perception. It's keyless. It's absolutely keyless. But it's given to you specifically, uniquely for you. So just let that sit. Could I drive it? Don't answer it. Just let it sit there. Let it percolate. That's what I'm doing. How much nervousness arises? How much anxiety arises? How much, you know, like, oh no, you know, recoil. Or enthusiasm, over enthusiasm. Let's see what your reactions are. It's just sort of giddy enthusiasm. It's like, oh wow, this is great, oh wow. Or, you know, our fear or whatever. Just look at your own mind and your own reactions. You have to be able to assess this. This will give you a very good barometer of the kind of pressure you're under from the ego still to not drive it. Because that red Ferrari in your driveway is actually pure perception, clear light vision of pure perception. Now, I had this. Let me not jump too quickly here. Let's not jump too quickly. Let's let this settle in. Let's wow it. Wow it. You know, keep wowing this. It is very intense. Put a huge amount of honey in here to try to cut this sourness. So now I get both the sour and the sweet. Wow. Ah. That's strong. So there might be all these perfunctory reactions to from everybody, you know, and projections. And of course, sensory perception gives rise to projection. And intrinsically it does. Because it's denying, it's, well, let's not go too fast here. It's important to not go too fast here. Full stop in the wow. Imagine driving up to a, you know, a resort hotel, and in that, you know, in the court, what was it, Port Cochet, you go up there, and the concierge comes up to you, the people, and they take your luggage, and you know, all these attendants come up and, "Well, welcome to our hotel," and this and stuff, and give valet park you, whatever. Or maybe you wouldn't do valet parking, but you might park it yourself. I think I'll park this on myself. But everyone's taking your luggage, and people, of course, are like kind of like peeking, like, "Whoa, who's this that just arrived in this awesome car? We've never seen a car quite like that. It's a really sweet ride." And so you deal with, the bellboys and everything, and you tip them, "Hi, how are you doing? And how would that go for you?" Drive to a market, I gotta get go out and get some food. I don't know where you're living, but if you're in Europe or United States, like Trader Joe's in the United States, or in Europe, I think that the guys that own Trader Joe's, they have their branch everywhere, right? You drive up to where that place, you get out, you walk in, get your groceries, push your cart out to the car, pop the trunk open, put the groceries in, bring the cart back, and then get in your car and drive off. And how would that go? Sitting at a traffic light, red light, just waiting. Start to turn, so pedestrians are walking. You stop, pedestrians walk by, and then you drive, and you just drive, like you always drive. How would that go? Just driving along in traffic. Somebody wants a ride. "Oh God, can I ride?" "Well, not right now, actually. I have sort of a policy right now. I get used to this. I'm not giving rides. But maybe later is possible. We'll see how it goes." I just think it's probably best not to give something one person a ride. Everybody wants a ride. It sort of starts, complicating stuff. So not right now. But that, people say, "Oh God, I want a ride. Can I have a ride?" Wow. Everybody's your friend, at least wants to be. But are you going to start like thinking, "Gee, I can get a whole bunch of friends now," or just keep your life the same? Or you can say, "Well, when you're ready." I mean, when you're really ready, maybe you'll get one of these. But you got to be ready to, you got to be able to hand, psychologically handle riding in this car. It's so I gotta, I have to be really selective about that issue. I've never a asked for a ride in anyone's car, actually. Never asked. I've seen these wonderful Aston Martins, and just people I could have asked for a ride. I could have. I mean, been talking with the people and know them socially. So I could have, sure. Could I? They gave rides to other people who asked, but I never asked. I never asked. But yeah, I'd say if they want to invite me, that's fine. But I'm not going to ask. I'm not going to beg. I'm not, it's. I wasn't ready to ride in the car. The car like that. You're not. It's if you're doing it, just it can be it's psychologically it can unbalance you actually. It can be very psychologically unbalancing if you're not ready for it, actually. The power, the speed, the luxury, the beauty, everything is like, oh my gosh, I have all this. How am I going to, how can I handle this in my life? It just, yeah, so it can be unnerving. So I realize, when the time comes, when I'm ready to handle a car like that, then we'll see how it goes at that point. But I'm not going to, and that's so. Discipline. You got to be disciplined. So sometimes not riding in it is even more profound. So I would say, can I get a ride? I say, not getting a ride might be the wisest move at this point. That being said to someone who wants asked for a ride, I'm just thinking, like how would you handle that? I say, well, yeah, I don't mind giving rides if the person it's they're ripe for that, but oftentimes, declining that is more beneficial. You have to look at it. What's most beneficial? Sometimes just having to feel like, I'm not quite ready. Realize I'm not quite ready to ride in that car. Don't push it. We'll see how it goes later on. See what kind of progress you make. Would I put a dog in the car? No pets in the car. I'm not gonna have a dog riding in the seat, no. A cat? Cats, they're too cool for that. I don't even need to. You ask a cat, you like to ride in the car? No. Forget it. I'm cool just sitting there. I got a good spot right here. I've got my own Ferrari. I am a Ferrari, the cat would say. I already got a sweet ride. Because that can go to people's heads, right? I mean, just intensely. It's like gold fever. Gold fever can grip people so badly. I mean, who's ready to hit the mother lode is the question. It's another mental exercise you can do. Is you're picking and shoveling it, and you're sand, water blasting. You're trying to get, find some gold, and you're water blasting this area, and you've uncovered this something. What is this? You start to see some glimmers of like, wow, it looks like. And there's some water covering and some silt in it, but it looks like there's like glimmers of gold there. You're like, wow, it looks like this is really something. And at some point, you've uncovered enough, and the vein of quartz there is just like, it's just heavily laced with gold. And the vein keeps going along. Well, you haven't uncovered it yet, but you don't see where it stops. And you say, this looks like substantial. This looks large. This looks huge. This is like, it's like a mother lode here. I've hit the quartz vein of gold here. What do you do? How do you handle that? Well, say, well, still got to get up in the morning and stretch and jump rope. So I'll just keep doing that. Go eat some. Go eat some dinner and get some rest and get up in the morning. Keep all your disciplines going, full stop in the wow, your practices. And just, see how it develops. Take one step at a time and just stay in the now as much as possible. Stay and just wow everything that's happening. Just wow it and just keep doing it, that's all. pretty soon, people will just get used to you. So that's the guy in the Ferrari, or this is the gal in the Ferrari. Yeah, it's really nice, it's cool. Wow, a beautiful, sweet ride. And they just, you know, just get used to it. And they're still like, wow, yeah, that's really, really nice. That's great. But they're starting to get used to it. And they start thinking, hey, you know, I wonder if that where'd they get that Ferrari? I wonder if I can ask them. I don't want to ride really, but I want to, where'd you get that Ferrari? How did you come by that? And that interests me, because I sort of had these dreams of a red Ferrari, and I sort of, like, when I come home, I think I see one in my driveway sometimes. You know, maybe it's just I'm making it up. Maybe I'm dreaming, hallucinating. I don't know, but I sort of like feel like maybe I might have one of those in my driveway. I don't know. You just, you know, then you could say, well, you know, let's talk about perception, and let's look at this. Let's look at this. But people are so defended against this that you might think it's just easy. Say, oh yeah, sure, that's pure perception. You can drive the Ferrari. It doesn't work that way. They may spend a lifetime trying to get over their compunction as far as just like, I can't drive that. You know, I can't drive that. I can't drive it. I don't have a right to drive it. I don't have a right to drive it. You know, it takes a lifetime of effort to try and get over this. What's the word? Reservations, or was that compunction? What's the word? Well, anyway, yeah, you know, just our reservations. Like, I can't really do that. So it's not easy. We're so defended against it. We've tried to convince ourselves that that's insanity to even think about it. That it's a symptom of insanity. We're going to go insane if we think about that. And we should have left that behind in childhood. We said, you know, so it's just, what we tell ourselves is that this is a symptom of dementia, that you're going insane in older age, thinking there's a red Ferrari in your driveway. Yeah, this is so that's something that you thought, you imagined when you were a child, but you got over that. So this is a sign that you're going back to your childhood, back in your dotage, where you're starting to think that means you're getting old, you're aging, getting dementia, and you need some medication, actually, the humoring and medication, and you know, hopefully you can get over this. And this is the attitude. Now, when I saw that guy in the Ferrari, I didn't really care about him or who he think he is. You know what? Now I said, "Wow, what a sweet ride that is." I don't really care who's driving it. It's just, it's just wow. So we're all looking at it. Wow, that is one sleek, beautiful car. It's so nice. So, you know, whoever's driving it, it doesn't really matter. It's okay. It's that we're not really focused on what the person looks like or anything. So people are not looking at you, they're looking at the car. Really, can you handle that? Can you handle that? Well, if you need to be humble, just jump rope for a little while. Say, I want to knock out a couple hundred. Really? Okay, how do you feel at 50? How about 100? Feel like going to 200? No. No. I can't seem to get past 100 straight. You know, I mean, it's just, you feel like, oh, that's enough. That's enough. I keep trying. Okay, I'm going to try to do as many as possible. Last time, I just tried it yesterday. I think it was yesterday. Okay, I'm going to try to get a couple hundred, maybe even 500. I'm just going to see how many I can do. At about 30, the rope broke at the handle. It broke. And said, no, you're not. I had to sit down and fix it. You're not going to try to max out. Just do 100. That's enough. You don't want to tire yourself out too much trying to just see how many you can do. But it's very, very humbling. Hmm. The color was like this red color. It was like a super mega Ferrari. It really was like a super mega Ferrari. This is not really showing the color that great, but it was a real shiny red color. Very nice. Yeah, just right, just right. Pure perception is like that. Now, if you're getting some qualms about it all, good. You're looking at this. Say, wow, I think I not know if I could handle that yet. Well, that would be my throughout my life. I've always tried to imagine a scenario of what I really want, something really great, but always get nervous about it. Say, no, I just can't handle that. I can't handle it. So I know exactly how that feels. But it's very good to make that assessment. And then later on, you do the assessment again at some point down the road, and you see, how am I now? But what I found is the qualms are much less as we're doing these practices, as we're full stop, as we're wowing this, what we're doing, just set perception down, sensory perception, exactly as it is. Don't try to fix it at all. Don't try to hot rod it. Don't try to hot rod the car in your driveway to make it look like that Ferrari, okay? That's called trying to fix perception. Trying to make sensory perception really great. This is the mistake we make. See, I don't need to drive that Ferrari. I don't know whose it is. I'm not going to drive. I can fix this car up to be just as good. Really? We can make sensory perception just as good as the vision of oneness, the vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Sensory perception shows us impermanence. Vision, clearly, vision of intrinsic spaciousness shows us the permanence of an permanence of abidance, intrinsic spaciousness of all everything. Very different feeling. There's no way we can hot rod sensory perception, but that's what we're all trying to do, actually. There's a way to practice looking at this. The whole idea of hot rodding perception is technologies trying to do that and offering us this, all these accessories and options that we don't need to drive that Ferrari. We got this car. Sensory perception is great. So looking at all that hot rodding accessories is interesting. I've been doing graphics lately over the Memorial Day weekend here in USA, Memorial Day weekend, and awesome graphics, just ridiculous, ridiculous. That's just hot rodding sensory perception, right? But in seeing this and doing it and seeing it, I just say, okay, yeah, that's not it. It's helpful because then it's sort of like a fire break where back burning it, where the whole vast forest of all these accessories to hot rod our vehicle of sensory perception, you just say, I've already taken a look at some really cool accessories and all that. I'm aware of all the coolness of all that, and so I'm not really, I'm not really interested in doing that. This is what I get out of it. So I find that, we just have to wow this, because this is like, oh my gosh, we're starting to see, oh my gosh, this is really what's going on, isn't it? We're just talking about it in a very relaxed Californian way, I guess. Which, is good. I like it. I like it. It seems to be very helpful and effective. There's a lot of hot rodding went on in California, that is for sure, especially Southern California. My dad grew up, well, starting when he was, I think, a teenager, young teenager. They moved to Southern California, and he was in the hot rod culture. He had hot rods, and everybody's working on there. Hot rod is like, that is part of the culture. You got these old cars and you just totally fixed them up so they just, just went faster and faster than heck. I mean, they're all, powerful and glistening with chrome and steel and all. It's just, really, I saw a hot rod recently. Someone had done a really nice job. It was pretty cool. Very cool look. Had an old Model T, Model T, but man, did they have some nice wheels on that. And it's very cherry, but understated. Very nice. I've never even ridden in a hot rod, actually, my whole life. Again, I've never asked to ride in one. I have many opportunities. I could say, "Hey, that's a great car. You might take me for a ride." I'm sure they say, "Oh, sure." Never have I asked for a ride in anyone's car. Very interesting. Because basically, I say, the car that I drive. First of all, I want to drive the car, and secondly, it's got to be my car. I have to feel comfortable with it. I'm not going to drive somebody else's car. You get the car that you're comfortable with. So, can't force the issue. Cannot force the issue. We get the perception we're comfortable with. So just let these questions just sit there. Let them sit there for the rest of the day and tomorrow and the next day, and just let it percolate. Just let it work on you. It's a kind of question that you don't have to answer right away. What kind of reactions which can arise? I say, well, we'll see. Down the road, I mean, maybe, I don't know, a couple of days, a week, whatever, you might suddenly say, you know what? This is how I feel about it. But it's like big issues, like you feel like moving somewhere. Say, well, let me just entertain this, but I don't want to, we'll see how I feel about it in general after a while. And that's just common sense and really important decisions is you don't try to just make a snap, eager decision. Just to say, let's just see how the overall gestalt of it all fits in, and is there just a feeling that, you know what, I feel like I could handle this. I feel comfortable with this. But that you give yourself a little time to see if it's comfortable, if it's a comfortable fit, not just a brief enthusiasm. But we're talking about actually, driving that car is your car. Every day you're driving it. Everywhere you go, you drive that car. So you got to feel comfortable in the car. It's not just like a one spin around the block and go, whoa, that was really awesome. Wow. No, you're literally driving that car now. It's the other one that's just sitting there in the driveway. Very cool exercise. I really love it. Just imagine different scenarios. Just lightly. Don't try to get too much into them. Just touch upon them. So we're really considering pure perception to change our form of perception. This is the real goal. This is the actual real goal. All the rest of the stuff is just whatever it is, what it is. But this is the real goal, changing your form of perception. It's been so difficult. It's so difficult for anyone to get to this recognition because we're taught, or we teach ourselves out of continuity fear, but there's this collective in endeavor here in this world to convince ourselves that driving that Ferrari in the driveway, it's not going to happen this life. It's just not going to happen. We can't do it. We can't do that. Massive, massive collective effort to have this, bring about this conclusion that Not this life. No, I can't do it. For whatever reason, it's just not going to happen. This is what we. So almost everyone comes to this conclusion, decision. Almost everyone. And yeah, so it's bizarre, isn't it, that everyone has that vehicle of pure perception in their driveway, and almost nobody drives it. You think the Holy Spirit might get tired? No, the Holy Spirit will never take it away from us. It's always going to be there. So we might as well drive it, right? It's not like we're going to get rid of it. It's always going to be there. It's always going to be bugging us. It's always going to be bugging us. The only way to stop being bugged by it is to drive it. Get in the car and drive it. It's the only way. It's the only way. Save you all those, therapy bills. Trying to say, "Doc, I'm not crazy, am I? I keep hallucinating this Ferrari." He says, "Well, what does that mean for you? What does it mean to you? What does it symbolize? I don't know. Ambition, success, glamour, So maybe it's all symbolic. It's symbolizing something in your psyche. No, it's pure perception is what it is, actually. You don't really hear the therapist saying that, do you? I never had a therapist tell me that. I went to all sorts of therapies because I said I believe in this, that there's this other vehicle of perception. Nobody believes it. It's driving me crazy. I'm an outcast. And so they said, "Well, we don't really know how to help you. You don't you won't admit that it's just symbolic or something, and you really believe in it, and it just there's nothing we can do for you." No, it's just. I said, no, I really, I deep down I believe it. It's really we do have that red Ferrari in our drive. Everybody does, and we're meant to drive it. It's put there by the Holy Spirit. We're meant to drive that car. We got to drive it. It'll bug us until we do it. And they said, "Ah, maybe that's transference, reaction formation, projection. Pay attention to your dreams. Maybe you see what it made some meaning in your dreams. Maybe it's just an inadequacy, feeling of inadequacy, or your repression, repressed material. There's maybe it's a relationship you're avoiding, with somebody." They come up with all these excuses, They never hit upon what it really is. They never hit upon it at all. And so that makes you feel a little worse. So even these therapists, they've gone through all this great schooling and they're so wise, they don't have a clue. They don't even drive their red Ferrari. In fact, they're trying to convince themselves that it doesn't even exist. And they'll confide to us, "I also sometimes have the same problem, but that's why what I went into therapy for. But I'm kind of getting over it. I'm a lot better. I don't think about that red Ferrari so much, anymore." And you can't really be cured. I can't say I'm cured, but I can help you at least get to accepting that you've got this problem and you just can't quite get rid of it. But you can learn to live with it. And it's all this finesse, all this therapy is just this finesse around this issue. So just play with this idea that this is what's important. You have to do it for yourself. You have to consider the scenario within your mind and see what your reactions are. It's not an intellectual conclusion we're trying to reach here. We're trying to literally allow this idea to entertain it and say, "Can I drive that red Ferrari? Can I drive it? Can I really drive it? I mean, literally, I'm going to do it. And what are my feelings about this?" I'm walking out to the car. You know, can I walk out to? Can I get behind the wheel? Can I, you know, turn the engine on? Can I, you know, back out the driveway? Can I go down the street? You know, just put yourself, imagine, you know, just put yourself in that scenario. Is it gonna, your whole life is suddenly going to be all, you're going to be driving to the beach and you know, and the radio blast and go cruising just as fast as you can now and have fun till our daddy takes the Ferrari away. We're going to, you know, just make up a party while it's ever, or you, your whole life suddenly turned into some big party. All the party girls showing up, you know, you get 10 of them standing on the Ferrari, drinking beer and dancing and stuff. I mean, is that what's going to happen? Or are you just going to, like, same old, same lifestyle, nothing changes, just driving a different vehicle right now? Very nice evening. It's warm. Summer just, boom, it's here. It's great. Just had to jump into it. Amazing. We had a very a cooler than normal May. It was really quite cool. Below average temperature, a little cloudiness and some rain. And then suddenly Memorial Day, bam. Man, are they getting scorching weather in a lot of places out west. Just scorching. So it just, summer's just started ferociously. And they're saying it's going to be a warmer, hotter than normal summer out west here. I don't know how it's going to be where you live. Long hot summer. Here's a question: do you feel comfortable driving in the car by yourself, or do you need some party person besides you, some glamour person, to make? Because you feel like, oh, I'm just, you know, I'm too humble to be driving this vehicle. I mean, it doesn't seem right. I need someone, you know, a trophy person. You become desperate, like, oh my gosh, I gotta have someone else in the car with me. I can't handle this myself. This is a question too, right? To ask yourself. Because this whole thing of fear, like, what if someone asked me for a ride? Is really our own projection of fear. Like, we think we're inadequate to drive it ourselves. We need someone there beside us to deflect some of the attention. Like, yeah, I don't really deserve the car, but the passenger does. You know, I'm just chauffeuring them around. It's really their car, but I'm just like a chauffeur or something. You know, start self-deprecating and feel like I'm not really worthy and that kind of thing. Interesting exercise. Very intense exercise. Wow. I found this scotch tape. This is how we use tape. You open up the box and it's got the reel of polyester tape in it. Wow, this is really pristine. It's never been used. This is completely pristine stuff. Oh, the tab is still there. Wow. This has never been used. This is... I found this 150 polyester, 50% extra play, splice-free magnetic tape. Very cool. This is what they use. The picture is musicians. You see that? Just the recording musicians. A little orchestra they got going there. Yeah. Make tight, noise-free splices. Interesting. So apparently they just tape, they just have this, you overlap the tape, you cut it in the middle of the overlap, and then you put this white tape on it, but you literally tape the tape, the recording tape, you have this other tape, and it literally, you tape it together. I didn't know that. Yeah, and that's how you made splices with the tape. Huh. Always with the show, the picture of how you do it there. Of course, these were used on reel-to-reel recorders, and this is a two-track, I think the tape said a couple two-track tape. They had four-track, and ultimately they got up to eight-track. Then they got up to 16. They got the real four-inch tape. It was really wide. So many tracks on it. But it started out with just single-track, the dual-track. So this is like a dual-track tape. This is what music was recorded on for a long time. It sounds great, music recorded on this magnetic tape. I like it better than it recorded digitally, actually. Digital sounds too robotic, too sterile. It just it's like you're trying too hard, you know, with digital stuff. Trying to hot rod your sensory perception too much, trying too hard to, right? There's something about, you know, it's like we're trying now. The world's trying too hard. Trying too hard. It's like someone is trying to look too impressive or too, you know. So when you're driving the Ferrari, you know, are you trying too hard? Personally, are you really trying? So people will say, are they trying too hard, or are they just that's just them? Is the question they'll have. Or the question you'll have, am I trying too hard here? Don't worry if you feel qualms about it. This is the whole point of the exercise, is become aware. This is very helpful to become aware of where you're at with this healed perception, with making this exchange, as Jesus says. We simply make an exchange of perception. He calls it belief system, but the root of belief system is actually perception. The eye is just perception, sensory perception, basically. It's a form of perception. So you exchange one form of perception for another form of perception is all I need to do. Instead of driving this car, we drive this other car. Still driving. The tree's still there. We just see it's abiding, perfectly abiding in intrinsic spaciousness. That's all. Still there. Everything's still here. The ground, the road, the car, everything's still here. It's just we see, wow, It's perfectly abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness, and it never leaves it at all. It's permanently doing that. You see permanence everywhere. There's just this one seamless, flawless tapestry of permanence, permanent abidance. Nothing ever leaves intrinsic spaciousness. But you still see everything. You still see the birds flying through the sky, but it's the motion that it's engaged in doesn't cause it to leave its own intrinsic spaciousness at all, does it? So, in terms of intrinsic spaciousness, everything is inherently still, is it not? Nothing's happening there. There's no movement out of it or into it at all. So this would be driving this Ferrari. You see it this way. So okay, I'm a Ferrari driver now. That's what I am. I'm a pure perceptionist. That's what I am. That's the perception I have for now. Maybe later I'll go back to the old sensory perception, but not right now. I'm gonna stick with this for a while. See how I like it. Now people might start inviting you to function, this function, that function, this party, this thing. They start getting invitations because they want that car to show up. So, wow, I mean, I want to bring this car over, man. Everybody wants to see it. And so maybe you have to think about, well, do I really want to do that or not? Maybe sometime I will. How can you handle that? You can say, well, I'll see how I can fit it into my schedule if I can, but I've got to keep doing the discipline, got to keep doing the stuff that I'm doing. And you might say that, or you might say, take every opportunity that comes. Oh, yeah, go here, go here, go here, go there. I don't know. You might become in demand. Everybody wants to see that car. Cherry coupe. But let's keep in mind that people have this massive defense systems designed to not drive the car. They really do. And they may want just to have that validated. I can't drive it, so they might try to idolize you, saying like, well, only you can drive that car. I did that to Jesus. Jesus, only you can drive that car. None of us can drive it. You're special, only son of God. The only one who can ever drive. We can't ever drive that. We're just human. Humans don't get to drive that car. Humans have to drive the car of sensory perception. Can't drive the car of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Only you can do that, Jesus. Jesus says, no. I came here to tell you that you too have that car in your driveway. We all do. That's what I came here to tell you. But instead, gets idolized and say, no. We can't do it. So that might arise, right? So all this defensiveness, all this defensive, so much, so much, so much, so much. And it might be that, you know, nobody drives it. They keep coming up with excuses. I was going to drive it, but I got sick. Sickness is an excuse. Sickness is just a defense against truth. It's a defense against driving that vehicle of pure perception, actually. Actually, it's a defense against truth. We're so afraid. If we only knew that there's this intermediate step of pure perception, you know, we wouldn't get sick, actually. This is what is so tough to handle, because I see people getting sick and dying. If they only knew they could drive this car of pure perception, they wouldn't need to get sick and die, actually. They might drop the body at some point, but they wouldn't really need to, but they could. But wouldn't need to get sick, wouldn't need to get infirm, wouldn't need to really, not really, no. They could, I mean, they don't need a defense against truth. They don't need to use sickness as a defense against truth. You drive this car, you say, oh, okay, this is good enough. I mean, vision, clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This is great. I'll just drive this car for a while. I really like this car. I really love this car. I'm going to drive it for a while. But I don't need to be sick. I don't need to suffer. I don't need to be tormented. Not at all. That's just a defense against truth. This is true. So, you know, it's sort of tragic that you tell people, look, you got this car, you drive, all you got to do is drive it. Nobody drives it, and they keep getting sick and dying. This is what happens here. So can you handle that difficulty of that? Tell you, those who are, you know, willing to look at this, is very helpful. Anyone who does drive the car, it's extremely helpful for the rest of us. And those who are willing to consider it, is very helpful, very extremely helpful. The more that do it, the more we start to go, hey, maybe I'm not crazy. Maybe there's that car there. It's possible, and you start. You know, start dropping all your defenses, but you start becoming less defensive about it. This is what happens when you start seeing, you know, some people tooling around in their red Ferrari. You say, hey, you know, and you see a bunch of them around town. You kind of say, well, maybe I, you know, in the back of your mind is like, maybe someday I'll drive one. Yeah. It's funny, right? Living here where I live, there's so much wealth from Silicon Valley that there's so many, many luxury cars being driven around. You name it, it's being driven around. Rolls Royces, Lamborghinis, Aston Martins, Bentleys, very popular, top of the line Jaguars, Mercedes, BMW, but just massive Range Rover, massive amount of luxury cars. There almost seems like half the people have luxury cars here. So you see them all the time, and so you're around them constantly. After a while, you just kind of feel like, oh, it's no big deal. Yeah. In the back of your mind, you say, oh, I could drive a car like that, because I see all these people driving them. I said, they're just, you know, it's kind of normal. It's become quite normal now. It's very interesting. The Rolls-Royce people are kind of interesting, though. They generally have a complex. There's a type that drives the Rolls-Royces. There's a lot of Rolls-Royces around here. Every day, not every day, but quite frequently you see them driving around. And it's a lot of times it's like, ladies drive these too. And it's a guy, he's usually like in a dressed up in a sport coat and a tie and a really nice, you know, button down shirt, and he's, you know, real, you know, never lets his guard down, you know, kind of stuffy attitude, and it's like they're prisoners of the car or something. They have to put on this image. The ladies, their hair is always done so nicely and elegantly, and there's this, and you know, she's dressed in rich clothing, and she's jewelry. They usually wear jewelry, driving my Rolls Royce. It's just a thing. They like doing that. It's enjoyable for them. So I'm happy for them. They're getting a kick out of it or something, or they're prisoners of it. I don't know. Yeah, you drive a Rolls Royce. That's a whole different story. Yeah. Anyway, so the idea is you get used to it here, and that's helpful. It's helpful, right? If that's your if you really want to drive a car like that, well, it's great to hang around a place where a lot of people are driving them. Not everybody, but a lot of people are driving them. You just see these cars all the time, constantly. Whereas if you don't, that's not the case. You saw all these cars, you're like, wow, that's okay. Maybe I. It strikes you really much more strongly and stands out. And you say, I don't want to stand out that much. This is really and too intense. If people are kind of blasé about it, you become blasé about it too. It's amazing, but it does happen that way. So the more of us who are driving the vehicle of pure perception, the more people start to get used to it. Say, oh, yeah, I might be able to drive that vehicle sometime myself, and actually I'm considering doing so. So I kind of want some tips, like how can I get over the jitters? I don't, I feel like, I still feels like a little, too rich for me. I don't know if I, that is my image. I don't want my image to be that necessarily. And can you tell me how to hot rod this vehicle? No, you can't tell me how to hot rod that. I got to drive this one. I'm not sure if I can handle it. So they start working on this whole thing. And of course, the answer is just keep full stop on the wow. Keep practicing wowing step by step by step by step by step. Wow, each step, maybe there's thousands and thousands of steps, little step, baby steps, baby steps, baby steps. Wow, each one. And then just keep doing these baby steps. And maybe eventually, baby step will be getting in that car and you just sit there in the seat, like, wow, I'm now sitting inside the car. Wow. And just sit there, don't drive it, just sit inside the car. And this becomes your new hangout place, just sitting inside the car. You don't have to drive it right away, you just sit there first. Get used to it. So everything in the car until you feel like, oh, this is just, comfortable. This is my hangout. This is my little cave here. And then maybe you'll hit the radio dial, We're always first to hit the lot and wave to the man in blue, yeah. We're turning on the radio dial. We can sit and listen for a while. Ooh. Parking Lot by the Beach Boys. Great song. The harmonies on that are just like awesome. Where did Brian Wilson come up with that stuff? It was so unique. He said, well, if we're fresher. No, that's we're fresher. Never sounded like that, really. There's some. It's just very unique. Maybe the greatest American musician of all time, Brian Wilson. To come up with that sound, it's just. Nobody heard anything like it. That's not easy to do. I was listening to some Beach Boys, and I said, that is not easy to do. To invent this new sound, and it sounds just fabulous. You just come up with that. Nobody had ever heard anything like it, and we haven't heard anything like it since, really. That is really quite something. That's what we say, musical genius. Brian Wilson is a musical genius, no question about it. So we just sit and listen. Sitting and just listen to the radio. Well, maybe put in a CD or whatever, however you play your music, and just listen to some music. Turning on the radio dial, we can sit and listen for a while. Yeah. Just sit and listen for a while. Get used to the interior. turn the windshield wipers on. Ah, oh, these work too. They work even better. But look how clear the glass is. We say, wow, so the glass is like super clear. In fact, there's no bugs on it. It's like, wow, I can see so beautifully in this car. This is like my ability to see when I, is so much better. And when I get inside the car, looking out the windows, it's just like, it's everything seems so bright and beautiful. Wow, that's really cool. I like this car. I like sitting in this car. Everything seems so peaceful as I sit in this car too. Lovely. I like this. So hopefully you're able to follow along with this, because we have to do this. We have to look at this now. We have to be able to practice like this to really give genuine consideration to pure perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Yeah, clear light perception, intrinsic spaciousness, pure perception, healed perception. The capacity to give genuine consideration to this is an antidote to the troubles of the world. Okay, this is what we're doing here. It's an antidote. It's a great antidote. It's a supremely effective medicine. Antidote, protection, refuge, is the ability to literally, genuinely consider this and start taking these baby steps. So imagine, okay, what? How can I interact? Maybe I can like just get near the car and just stand there like this. Maybe that's the step you can take. But you're engaged. Your goal is, I have a goal of driving that car ultimately. But for, you know, first I'm going to sit in it. But first I'm going to just stand there and look at it. Maybe I'll just touch it, you know, something. Touch the car, or just get near it like this and just see how it smells. Smell the car. Listen to the car. How's it sound? Is there a sound from the car? What's the vibe of the car? What's it feel like? What's the car feel like? Just looking at it. How's it feel? Start doing these little baby steps. It's funny. Let me not jump ahead. We're going fast enough here. I got to keep reining myself in, because I've already been working at this a little bit here, so I think I can make a rush ahead. But no, just plod along here. Just consider yourself here, just standing there, looking at it. We can stand and listen. We can stand and look for a while. In the parking lot, the Beach Boys. What a song. Just imagine back in 1964 or something, that came on the radio. That was a mind blower back then. Absolute mind blower. Beach Boys just blew my mind. Blew a lot of people's minds. They really did. Where in the world? Where did that come? We couldn't figure it out. What happened? Where is this music coming from? It's coming from heaven or something? It's just like too much. Wow. The warmth of the sound and the resonance. Of course, they're using the Neumann for 47s or something. The recording studios and the echo chamber. A lot of stuff, technical stuff, magnetic tape, really good magnetic tape. It was the whole ball of wax. But it was the arrangements and the tonal qualities of the singers, the timbre of their voices, you know, the pitch, the confidence they sang with. It was everything. There's so much to it, actually. They hit it all, you know, hit on all cylinders, actually. They had some swagger. Mike Love gave them the swagger. A sort of like smooth swagger, all in harmony. It was like a red Ferrari, wasn't it? Their music. It's like someone driving by and there's this red, beautiful red Ferrari. You just go, what in the world is that? Never see anything like that. There's this YouTube channel. a young man from Canada who does covers, does some of the Beach Boys songs. Just it's just him, or there's this internet site, smileysmile.net, I think, or something like that, where these musicians, they collaborate, and they've done some collaborations. He did just by himself, Don't Worry Baby. And it was just, wow. They did another song, what was it? That was so good. I was blown away by what they did. The young men, and from Canada, I believe, at least he has. I don't know where the people from Smiley Smile are, but he had some musicians help him. I think they're Canadians. They just nailed the Beach Boys. I was just like so impressive. I can't remember the name of the song that one they did that was really, really well done. Gosh, it's just almost unbelievable, really. I've never heard anybody do it that well. It's very difficult to just nail it like that. And this one guy just did it by overdubbing his parts. He did all the instruments and all the overdubbing. I think Don't Worry Baby, he did the darn good, really good. I think it was Don't Worry Baby, yeah. Wish they'd do more of them. It's just so impressive. Anyway. There's some groups. We had this group called Papa Duran Duran that did the like Beach Boys style. A lot of surf groups tried to do Beach Boys style. It never sounded like the Beach Boys. No way. There's too many elements that go into it. You know, the Wrecking Crew playing behind them, the instrumentation, the mixing board. I mean, Gold Star Studios had all these very inventive. They invented. They made their own. You know, consoles, mixing consoles, wire, a lot of stuff they made there, custom. They got such a great sound out of that stuff. Wow, just crazy good sound. Never, I don't think it's ever been topped or even equaled. But of course, that's just hot rotting sensory perception, isn't it? So that's what actually caused me problems. Beach Boys caused me problems because I said, wow, that is such a cool hot routing of perception. Wow. And then I started paying attention to that more than I did to my red Ferrari of pure perception. And gradually, you know, went away from it. Music pulled me in. It was the Beach Boys was the one who started that. Because they did like the best job hot rodding music ever, really, in my opinion. You know, there's other hot rodders of music, like Bach did a pretty cool job. But the way, just all the elements that were involved with the Beach Boys, I believe they did the best job of hot rodding it. And just they, meaning the whole collaborative team of the musicians, the Wrecking Crew, who are just insanely inventive on their instruments. Just I don't even know what they're playing, really. What, you know, they just came up with such an amazing stylistic riffs and tones and everything, and blending, the mixing, the blending, the tape, the microphone, everything, the confidence, the swagger of Hal Blaine and the Wrecking Crew is just amazing. You know, the swagger of the Beach Boys, you could just get the swagger of L.A. The swag was just off the charts. Off the charts. And just the swag, the whole idea, we're in the best place in the world. Everybody believed it and lived in Southern Cal. You know, SoCal, they believe this is the best place in the world. There's no question about it. There's some Mike Loves out there in the corridor writing California Girls, you know. He says, get some pad of paper. Ryan Wilson has some chords. I'm going to write this song. What swagger is that, you know, to write that song? He said, we live in the best place in the world. The girls are the best in the world here. You know, no question. Everything's the best here. And they believed it. They believed it. They really believed it. And who's to argue with them, actually? So you just had this, just you talk about Phil Spector's wall of sound. Well, the Beach Boys was a wall of swagger. It really was a wall of confidence. That's what hit me. I never heard such confidence before. It's a different kind of confidence. And Brian Wilson was so confident. I mean, he's just un unbelievable unbelievability in terms of music confidence. Yeah, it just. So this hit me, and I could feel it being a musician myself. I could feel it. I said, "Holy cow, this is just off the charts! How in the world did they pull this off? This is a musical coup." Yeah, the Beach Boys were a musical coup, historic musical coup, actually. And being a student of musical history, and being part of musical history myself, writing part of that history, I could tell the Beach Boys were a musical coup. Just knocked it out of the park. That confidence, just launching in, like this beginning of "Don't Worry, Baby." That Hal Blaine starts to drop. Like that. Just like what? What? And then Brian Wilson's singing, which I did find out. I believe I heard he was double tracking it, and someone wrote a comment who was very certain that he did double track his leads. And I thought I heard he was doing that. Yeah, it's so well done. You know, it's just very difficult to determine. But I said, you know, the richness I feel, it really sounds like he's actually, you know, he did his vocal twice and put the two tracks together, multi-tracked his vocal, doubled up on his vocal. Is so confident. The vocals is awesome. "Don't Worry, Baby," one of the best vocal performances I think anyone's ever heard, actually. If you listen to it carefully, that sound of Brian Wilson's voice singing, and it just nails it. It's just awesome, awesome vocal performance there, actually. It's perfect. Listen to the end of it, the subtleties in his voice. I mean, the nuances. Good Lord, how did he come up with that? Write the song, come up with it, and it's just amazing, amazing stuff. That just, you know, it just rises above the other stuff. Music is, like I said, it's just a musical high water mark for all music throughout history. I don't care what you're talking about, Mozart, Bach, minstrel music and choral music. Any music, jazz, you name any music, blues, blah, 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 blah. This is a high water mark. All the classical stuff and everything that came before that, and chamber music, courtly music, opera, you name it. Just that beginning to "Don't Worry, Baby," just listen to it. They actually got the echo chamber on Hal Blaine's drums just right for that, actually. There's a whole thing about that. That it's hard to tune the studio. I think that they recorded that the way they got the echo chamber, and boom, perfect, perfect, perfect. They talked about that. That was very difficult, but they got all the mics and everything worked out great. I believe it was on that one. And even to this day, what was it, May 17th, 1964? Fifty-two years later, it still just absolutely hits me like, wow. What a hot rod job they did. But you gotta put it in context. It's hot rodding perception. Okay, which is what we don't want to do, actually. We want to allow perception just exactly as it is. Whatever we're perceiving, sensory perception, just set it down, and then, like a car, get out of the car, go over, and then drive the Ferrari. Drive the Ferrari of pure perception. But I certainly got swept up in this whole hot riding of music thing, hot riding of perception. The Beatles came along with their jingle and their jangle, and that angle. The Beechnut Bubblegum Teeny Boppers loved the Beatles. Scream, they could scream and chew their gum at the same time somehow. I don't know how they did that. You know, the Beatles, the Mop Tops, you know, there's little, like this, you know, their accents and the suits and little suits and, you know, black tie and everything. I want to hold your head. Screaming, I want to hold your hand. I want to hold your hand. It's like, oh my God. Paul, he was just like, oh. It was a different thing. It was a Teeny Bopper thing. They, you know, raging hormones, the Teeny Boppers, the Beatles were hitting those hormones. Where the Beach Boys is a different thing. They were just like hitting the swagger. Like, we're the most boss music group that's ever been in the history of the world. And here we are. Deal with it. Okay. And they really felt they were. That's the thing. They really believed they were. They believed, they knew they were. I mean, this setup, they realized, we're the greatest. Nobody can come close to this. And here it is, and we're just going to hit your ears with it. We're going to hot rod this like you wouldn't believe. We're going to hot rod your listening experience like you can't believe. And it was like raw. It was just basic, but it was just boom. Everything then became very sophisticated and all this kind of stuff. But it didn't have that just visceral, just here we come. Look at this hot rod. It's just coming down the road. This thing is just cherry coupe. It's just absolutely wow. First time you see it, you just, you know, the candy apple red and the wax job and the chrome and the whole impression of everything of this hot rod coming out, you just wow. And this thing, you know, this is just the best hot rod in town. If somebody picks me, they don't even try. Says I'm money. Picks me, they don't even try. Or sees me, they don't even try. She's my little loose coupe. You don't know what I've got. Got a competition clutch and a four on the floor, and she purrs like a kitten when her tailpipes roar. And if that ain't enough to make you flip your lid, there's one more thing. I got the pink slip, daddy. Come on off the line when the light turns green, like she blows them out of the water like you never seen. I get pushed out of shape and it's hard to steer when I get rubber in all four gears. She's my little loose coupe. You don't know what I got, little loose coupe. You don't know what I got. That's the Beach Boys, little loose coupe. There's another swagger song, right? Man, just SoCal swagger. Was just. Came from hot rod culture, surf culture, hot rod culture, all the blend of this culture of just says, we're the bossest people that ever lived on the planet. And Brian Wilson says, yeah, I'll put this whole thing to music. Watch me put this all to music. And he did. So this hooked us into hot rodding perception, sensory perception, which is not a good thing, actually. It's what we don't want to do. We want right this instant, just letting the world be exactly as it is this very instant. We call the world, meaning sensory perception, how my experience of sensory perception. We're really just experiencing perception. So let my experience of sensory perception be exactly as it is this very moment, and I shift my attention, full attention, over to clear my experience of the perception of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. That's all. Just do that. And that's not hot rodding sensory perception. That's driving that Ferrari over there. And that makes the hot rodders stop. Turn their heads and say, what the heck is that? They lose focus on their hot rod, you know. It's like, yeah, they're sitting there, you know, they're sleeves rolled up, you know, cigarettes in their sleeves, and looking at all the chrome, like, yeah, I got double headers on this, dual carb, you know, this is going to push, you know, the cam rods, you know, the camshafts, the push rods, blah, 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 the fuel injected. And there's this red fry right by that. I mean, yeah, he goes, oh, yeah, I got this, and I got this part, aftermarket part, that really helps do this. I said, what's that? What's that? Wow. What is that? Wow. Wow, as a driver, wow, 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 wow. And for a little while, they forget all about their sensory perception, their hot riding of a sensory perception. They just completely forget about it. And they kind of look at their hot rod and says, "What the heck? What am I doing with this thing? It's never going to be that Ferrari over there, is it? I don't think so. Wow, that's a whole different level of that's a whole different type of perception, isn't it? So they make even the grease monkeys, you know, stop and forget about what they're doing as they're tinkering with their sensory perception." The druggies are tinkering with sensory perception. Make even them stop. Stop their drug taking, just say. The sex maniacs all tinkering with sensory perception. The rock and rollers, you know, tinkering with sensory perception. The whole world tinkering with sensory perception. Get them to stop for a moment. Or somebody comes up. To be, they don't even try. What they do, they so they drive up, you know, and they're just cruising in the valley or wherever they cruise, and come to a stoplight. They're driving along. Someone comes up to you at the stoplight, blah, 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 and they kind of look. You look at each other. You want to like, you want to drag race to the next stoplight. Well, they, what should they do? I mean, nighttime, early morning, or whatever. There's no cops around. The streets are wide. And they could drag race. They drag race on the streets, and so they kind of be looking at each other. But the idea is he's looking at his little deuce coupe, and they say, "Ah, someone comes up to me. They don't even try. She's my little deuce coupe. You don't know what I got." They say, "Ah. Nice car. See you later. You know, okay, I'm not gonna drag race you." That's the SoCal culture of the time. When you're done drag racing, you go to the beach. You go surfing. Or if you're not surfing, you're skateboarding. You're driving your little deuce coupe, and on the radio comes, "I get around. Round, round, get around, I get around, yeah. Get around, woo, I get around. I'm getting bugged driving up and down the same old strip. I gotta find a new place where the kids are hip. Where'd they come up with that backing track? I don't know. I never heard a song like that before. It was mind-blowing. I get around, round, get around, I get around town to town. I'm a real cool head, I'm making real good bread. Woo, 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 round, round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around. Woo, I get around, doo, 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 round, get around, I get around." Well, this comes on the radio, and you're down in SoCal, driving to Santa Monica, and you've got this, your deuce coupe, and you're listening to this, you're going to the burger stand, and it's just like, wow. People just say, "We're the coolest people in the history of the universe." That was their purpose, I'm telling you. That was the vibe they're giving out. It says, "We know how to hot rod sensory perception." Of course, the whole Hollywood thing is also hot rodding sensory perception. The whole SoCal thing is all about that. Most potent form of it ever, actually. It really was. It's not like it used to be. That's for sure. But back then, spread over the whole planet. Beach Boys are known over the whole world, actually. They've toured the world many times over. It's bringing that SoCal swagger. Everywhere. we'll say we know how to hot rod sensory perception better than anyone, and this is good enough for you. Good vibrations. Gotta keep those love and good vibrations happening with her. Gotta keep those. I'm not saying it. I can't sing it. It's like, what time is it? It's like 11:30 at night, and I'm outside. But I can sing it. If I sing, I can sing all those songs. I can sing the same parts of Brian Wilson, actually. I had a falsetto voice like he did. I can sing that way. Not as good as he could do it, though. His was more natural. I guess that's the way he sang. I can go up there and sing all the parts, but it's not as good. It's not quite as good, really. He was like, just sounded great. What kind of voice is that? Wow. Naturally that way. Yeah. Gotta keep those love and good vibrations happening with where did they come up with those songs? I don't know. It's amazing. Good vibration. So that's the whole thing. The vibrations, the good vibrations are there. It's like they said, we got the best vibrations in the world. And it's so modern. Remember, LA was like founded in basically the 20th century. Before, it was just like desert, scrubland, ranchland, scrubland. It was all just made like that. They just, wealthy Easterners just built the whole city, spread it out all over the different places with roads connecting it. It was like they're trying to build utopia. This is how LA was formed. It's just like amazing. There's never been a city quite like it, actually. And so from the very beginning, the idea was, we're going to build a utopia. We're going to hot rod sensory perception like it's never been done before. And then out of, you know, the movie industry moved out there. Okay, and the glamour was centered there, and the music industry, entertainment industry, the money was pouring into the place. Wealthy, intelligent, the defense industry was there after World War One and Two. You know, Long Beach was used as a port, and the oil, a lot of oil down there. So it was just this amazing success story, Los Angeles, and then the Beach Boys just captured it all, the swagger of it all. You know, going to Surf City, two girls for every boy. Well, I'm going to Surf. Yeah. Going to Surf City, because it's 2-1. And I'm going to Surf City, because it's 2-1. Da da da. I think that the Beach Boys, that Jan and Dean. Anyway, it might have been Jan and Dean that Brian Wilson wrote that with, I think, Roger Christian. But the swagger is just insane. My parents were both from there. Grandparents lived there, you know, but weren't originally from there. You go down there, it's beautiful. The lawns, the flowers, back then, the vibe, and you just, back like in the 60s, LA in the 60s, the 40s, 50s, 60s, you know, that kind of, oh my gosh, it's the palm trees everywhere, just an awesome city, city of the angels, Los Angeles, city of the angels, actually. Which is what hot rodding sensory perception is, what it is. And the glamour of all the celebrities there, right? Absolutely. The glamour and the modern architecture, the modernist architecture, there's so much modernist architecture. You have the old classical style, which was formed, and the buildings are all designed to give this certain impression, the way they designed it all ahead of time. LA was a design city. When I mean LA, I mean the greater area, the suburbs, all these different areas, Pasadena, Glendale, Burbank, Santa Monica, they designed the greater area to be this, so that put the civic centers and the libraries and all this, all these different places. But they design these the buildings ahead of time, a vision of this big area. So this gorgeous old architecture designed this way, and then the modernists came in. It's all this modern architecture there. It's just amazing. Everybody has so much confidence in their style. Like we you know, it came out of the World War II, for instance, and you know, the aerospace, aerotech, or what do you call it, aerospace industry, modernist materials, glass, aluminum, all sorts of modernist materials were used there. You know, LA airports are modernist looking, and people just felt like they were living in the hippest, modernist, most place with the most beautiful people, because the sun, you can be outside 365 days a year, literally. Santa Monica, you can live there 360 days a year outside. You know, the temperature is so equal there. Laguna Beach, you know, just these places. So the people are so tan. Everyone's hair got kind of blondish from being out in the sun so much. Good orthodontic people, they could afford braces, and their teeth were so nice. The food was great down there. The air got bad, started getting smoggy down there's a problem, but you know, they just were living the life of Riley down there. It's just amazing. And the beautiful flora, I mean the plants and the gardens that people had was just insane. It's just beautiful. Everything grew there. You know, you could grow bougainvillea blooming year-round. All these tropical plants could grow there and bloom year-round, kind of thing. And it just like it's intoxicating. LA was absolutely intoxicating. Then added the movie industry, you know, shooting all these movies there. Then people were just, you know, just thought LA was like the coolest place in the universe. And they certainly thought they were. Now, being born and raised in Northern California, I couldn't understand, like, my dad's attitude. I couldn't really understand. I said, why does he think he's so cool? I don't feel so cool here. I don't get it. Northern Californians are not that way. It's different. It's very different. Very different. How come we can't grow the stuff they did in L.A.? We tried to grow gardenias, you know, and bougainvillea, and all, and they die in the winter. They couldn't grow good palm trees up here. And I said, why can't we be cool like L.A.? You know, why can't we have all that vibe here? But no, that's very different. So the Beach Boys' music made it feel like, oh, wow, if only we could be in Southern California, we'd be happy. If only we could be there, we'd really be happy. So I always thought, why don't we move down there? It's crazy. Why are we living in Northern California? Everyone's miserable here. They're all uptight and miserable. Nobody's really happy here. Nobody has that laid-back SoCal vibe feel to them. Nobody really has that swagger here. We're all insecure, actually. Southern California, everybody thinks, hey, we're the most beautiful, greatest people in the world. Hi, how are you doing? How you doing? I'm doing great. They're very confident in their coolness down there. At least they used to be. But up here, nobody's confident in their coolness. Everybody's kind of unsure about it. Like an insecurity complex. Like Giant fans, you hate the Dodger fans. They're really insecure, actually. Because being a lifelong Giant fan is insecurity. Because the Dodgers had Chavez Ravine, the beautiful Dodger Stadium. Welcome to beautiful Dodger Stadium in Chavez Ravine. You know, I'm Ben Scully with Jerry Doggett and Ross Porter. And welcome to another night of Dodger baseball brought to you by Farmer John. You know, it's balmy and beautiful down there. People are hitting beach balls at night games. And here you're up, you're freezing at Candlestick Park. Just absolutely freezing up here. And you're just saying, like, God, this is terrible. I mean, you know, if I was down, I live in L.A., I could be a Dodger fan, but I can't, so I got to hate the Dodgers. So the Giant fans just hate the Dodgers. It's insecurity. It's insecurity because we think they have it better. They have it better. Beautiful, better ballpark. Candlestick Park was a dump. Worst ballpark. It's just terrible. I almost died of hypothermia there a number of times. It's hideous. And Chavez Ravine is just gorgeous. I went to a baseball game there once. I think I did. Did I? I'm trying to remember. I think I did. I I got the impression I did, yeah. It's beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Gosh. The sea breeze, you know, a little sea air coming in, it cools it down a little bit from the hot summer day. People are out there in short sleeve shirts at nighttime. You just say, wow, why can't I be that cool to live there? And you get the night show with Johnny Carson on, all the celebrities are coming on, they're all living there, and it's just, say, why can't I live there? Okay, so very interesting. This is, it's all about hot rodding sensory perception. So having lived through this, you know, I get it, I understand this issue very, very well. And the temptation we have to try and do that. Been there and done that. People of Northern California, they all started taking drugs. It's because they were insecure. They tried to say, we gotta compete with Southern California. We gotta come up with our own culture. It's better than theirs. You know, we gotta be cooler than they are. So they started using drugs. Very much San Francisco area, very much a drug center, has been so. The people in LA, not so much. It's like, I mean, we're so cool. We don't need drugs. What do we need drugs for? We're like totally cool and confident, and we're the best people in the best place in the world. And, you know what? So, but nah, Northern California, we got to compete. We got to beat them. We got to be better. But you can't really beat it. In terms of, you know, if you want a hot rod perception, that's the place, right? It's not like it used to be. Of course, demographics have changed, and culture has changed, and it's super crowded, and the traffic is terrible. Those have always been pretty terrible for a long time. But you still go down, if you're down there, you're driving, and people are still in their convertibles, and they're still just like, I'm the coolest cat in the universe, and everybody says, yeah, I am too. And it's just kind of like natural for him. It's just like, see some guy in this convertible Camaro, you know, he's just got the, you know, his arm out the side of the door, he's just like one hand on the wheel, got the radio on, just like sunglasses, and just like, yeah, I might be a celebrity. I should be a celebrity, you know. I'm as cool as the celebrities, yeah. And yeah, we're all celebrities. There's celebrity. Oh, yeah, I met a celebrity yesterday. One celebrity here, celebrity there. This is where the cool people hang out. And it's not, you know, it's just that this is just how they are, and they're very nice. They're very nice because they're always in celebrity style there. Like they're trying to, you know, like, the celebrity is supposed to be nice, you know, the fans, like they say, well, maybe you're a fan of mine, you know, so hi, really nice to meet you, you know, yeah, kind of say, you probably know me, you probably see me on television, you know, I'm sure you have at some point. Yeah, this is their attitude. So you know you're talking to someone like really, really cool, but that's okay, you know, I love my fans. And so they're nice to you, but in a way of like that you're a fan of their celebrityness and their coolness, and that's great. They think, this is great. I love my fans. You want my autograph? Sure. Of course, if you don't ask their autograph, they're kind of like, huh, maybe they don't get out so much. Right? You know, maybe they, you know, they need to watch a few more shows, you know, so they could see me on there. I mean, this is literally how it is. I'm telling you how it is. if you're aware and sensitive enough, it's just this is really. It they're not insecure. They're walking their dog. And the lady's walking her dog, and she's as far as anybody is concerned, I'm like some super celebrity. I'm Greta Garbo. I could be Greta Garbo. In fact, I should be Greta Garbo, actually. In fact, I'm even better than Greta Garbo. But just my time will come. That I'm just waiting for that part. I just gotta find the right part, and then people will realize I'm even cooler than Greta Garbo. And but until that part comes, I'm not gonna worry about it. I know I'm totally cool. And everybody who's cool around me, they'll recognize my coolness, so my greatness, it'll happen. So, hello, good morning, good morning, good morning. We're all stars down here. Hello.